Last time, we learned about the Michelson-Morley Experiment and its striking implications about the behavior of light. There was a lack of evidence that light traveled at sea through the ether. As it turns out, light travels at sea relative to everyone, even if they, themselves, are traveling at near-light speed, which appears to make no sense. Why does it make no sense? Because weird stuff happens as a result. Like this. You say this light burst hits both back and front of the bus at the same time, and your friend says they hit at different times. The reason that all this seems so contradictory is that we've made certain assumptions about the behavior of space and time. As human beings living at our slow lives, moving slowly relative to anything and everything we interact with, we do not usually encounter relativity in our everyday experience. We don't grow up thinking in relativity, but we can learn to. Believe it or not, this problem of simultaneity can be resolved. We know it must be true because of the Michelson-Morley experiment, and we know it can be true because it is possible to create a self-consistent model to describe all of this. In other words, it works! Let me explain. Let's do another experiment. This is a light clock, the world's most perfect hypothetical clock. It works by having a beam of light bounce back and forth between two mirrors. Each time the light bounces, the clock ticks. Let us involve you, your friend, and the bus again. Your next experiment is to see how this clock behaves. You place a light clock traveling along with you and the bus. Your friend watches your clock and compares it with his light clock on the ground. Notice that to him, your clock is moving, so the light beam must bounce on a diagonal path. It had to travel a longer distance. Since light must always travel at sea, your friend would see more time between ticks on your clock than on his. The moving clock runs slow. Is the clock broken? Did we just construct a clock that doesn't work when it's in motion? Well, we can check. When you look at your own clock, it works just fine, because you see the light travel directly up and down at sea. Everyone measures light to be C, regardless of their state of motion. So, according to you, the light clock works as it should. The fact that your friend sees your clock moving slow, and you see it running fine, must mean that your perception of time has slowed down, just as your clock has. Not only that, even your actions, your heartbeat, your thoughts, everything appears slowed down, because you see them behaving normally, and your friend sees them moving at the same rate as your clock. Your friend concludes that your time is moving slow. But how slow? Hey, look at that! A right-angled triangle. We can use the Pythagorean theorem. This is the path that the light beam took from your perspective. The length of this path is the speed of the light beam, c, times the amount of time between ticks according to you, t prime. Distance equals speed times time. This is the path that your friend says the light beam took. Its distance is the speed of the light beam, c, times the time between ticks for him, t. And this is the distance that your friend says your clock traveled between ticks. It is the forward speed of the clock, v, times the time between ticks according to your friend, t. Now, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. And look, we get a relationship between what you and your friend say about your clock. You say that its ticks occur t prime apart, and your friend says that the ticks occur t apart. And this is the factor. It turns out that this factor appears fairly often in relativity, and it is way too long, so physicists just write a lowercase gamma. Because of its formulation, gamma is 1 when there is no relative motion, and it is greater than 1 when there is motion. But only with sufficient motion, like going half the speed of light, will gamma grow noticeable, and time dilation become apparent. You might also notice that gamma approaches infinity as speed approaches the speed of light. But that's a story for another time. So, that's great. Your friend says you're moving, so your perception of time slows down by a factor of gamma. Right? Yes, but not exactly. What if we looked at your friend's clock on the ground? Now, according to him, the clock works fine, but the clock is moving according to you, so you notice that your friend's clock is moving slowly. We could even derive the slowing of your friend's clock by using the same algebraic procedures as last time, only now, your time and your friend's time are reversed. So, according to you, your friend's perception of time is slower than yours. And according to your friend, your perception of time is slower than his. Huh? How can both your clocks each be running slower than the other? Okay, hear me out. If we continue this process of using light clocks and other thought machines and thought experiments, we can derive length contraction and relative simultaneity. Now, these facts are paradoxical too. They say, respectively, that you and your friend should see each other as contracted, and you and your friend cannot agree on simultaneous events. But, in a mathematical miracle, these paradoxes fix each other. They make no sense individually, but taken together, all inconsistencies work themselves out in the math and disappear. I know, this seems completely out of it, I don't have enough time to go into too much detail here, but the point is, 1, relativity is weird, but 2, this weirdness can be resolved, because all the inconsistencies disappear when we have the full formulation. And 3, we know that this weird and self-consistent model of space and time is real, because all of it stemmed from the fact that light travels at sea relative to everybody, which is something that has been measured experimentally more than 100 years ago. This all must be true, because it all comes as a consequence of something we know to be true. Still not convinced? Time dilation has been measured directly. Particles that naturally decay tend to live longer when they are in particle accelerators. The faster they go relative to the rest of the world, the longer they live. Their lifespan has increased, because according to us, their time appears slow. All of this. The time dilation. The length contraction. The simultaneity. The paradoxes. The fact that the paradoxes are resolved by mathematics which goes further than anyone could ever imagine. This is special relativity. And, despite how distressingly complicated it is, with its slish-sloshing about of space and time, it is the only way to explain how light can do what it did in the Michelson-Morley experiment, how particles can do what they do in particle accelerators, and much more. The fact is that we live in a world which makes no sense, because we don't directly encounter this side of reality in our everyday lives. But this true nature of the world is here. It's complex, it's unintuitive, but it's here and it's real, and we get to live in this crazy reality. And that? I think that is pretty awesome.